balls and one strike to Mike Davis. Bottom of the ninth. A's 4, Dodgers 3.
This is the story of the 1988 Los Angeles Dodgers. It's a story full of hope and elation.
3-1. And he walked it. And look who's coming up.
Of grit, determination, and a tremendous amount of desire.
All year long, they look to him to light the fire. And all year long, he answered the demands until he was physically unable to start tonight with two bad legs. And with two out, you talk about a roll of the dice. This is it.
It's a story of a team playing its heart out for each other. And above all, for our great fans.
Sacks waiting on deck, but the game right now is at the plate. High fly ball into right field. She is gone! In a year that has been so
and most of all, it's the story best told through the eyes of a winner.
...1988 turned out to be a year of celebration for the Los Angeles Dodgers. A year of enduring heroes and improbable endings. A year that touched us all. But looking back, who could possibly have known what lay ahead for these Dodgers? This was, after all, a team coming off two consecutive subpar seasons. A team that very well could have been headed for a third. There were, however, those in the Dodgers organization who saw what needed to be done.
When we went to the meetings in Dallas in December, we knew that we were last in hitting in the National League, and we knew that we led the National League in errors and came very close to leading the Major League in errors. We also knew that our bullpen was very ineffective, so we had to do something about it.
The man ultimately responsible for doing something about it was Fred Clair, whose offseason moves gave the 88 Dodgers a completely different look. Acquired by trade, shortstop Alfredo Griffin, and relievers Jay Howell and Jesse Orozco. Through the free agent market, Clair acquired Mike Davis and then Kirk Gibson, all of whom would make substantial contributions in 88.
From the very outset, from spring training, I think that all of us with the ball club had a sense that this combination was going to work, that there was a very positive attitude, that there were players that had a true dedication to win, and I think that dedication just grew as we went through the season day by day.
The first day of the 88 season was April 4th. That afternoon, among the pomp and circumstance usually associated with opening day, four members of the Dodgers' last World Championship team threw out the ceremonial first ball. Looking back, it was a touch ironic that Steve Garvey, Ron Say, Dusty Baker, and Reggie Smith would throw out the first pitch. But what might have been even more ironic was what Steve Sachs did with the real one.
Sachs, it's a high drive into left field, down the line, gone, home run. Boy, you talk about pulling the cork on a bottle of champagne. The first pitch of 1988 by Dave Dravecki, and Steve Sachs hits it in the left field seats.
That, however, would be the end of the Dodgers' heroics for the day. Fernando Valenzuela ultimately lost the early lead and then the game as the Giants beat the Dodgers 5-1. The situation, however, improved quickly as the Dodgers won their next five games and went on to finish the month of April with a 13-7 record. Considering the failures of the past two seasons, getting off to a fast start was important to the 88 Dodgers, and so was the manner in which they did it. In fact, the signs were so positive early on that the Dodgers actually began to think about becoming number one. I'm outside, rolling in the morning sun. No matter what it takes, no, I'm gonna get it done. Pushing up the hill, fighting through the pain. Everything to lose, everything to gain. No, I'm on my way, I'm on my way to number. Who was living right? For one, Oral Hershiser, who won five games in April without losing and finished the month with a 1.56 ERA, thanks in part to the resurgence of the Dodger defense. Newly acquired shortstop Alfredo Griffin lived up to his defensive billings and stabilized the infield. But what surprised many was his 13 RBIs in April. That was just one RBI behind Pedro Guerrero, who led the team with 14 before an injury would take him out of the lineup. As a team, the Dodgers led the league in hitting, and right at the top was catcher Mike Socha, who unexpectedly found himself leading the National League with a .404 average, as the Dodgers finished the month in second place, just one half game behind the Astros.
I was happy about my start. It isn't every day I find myself leading the league in hitting. To tell you the truth, though, I was even happier that the team was going so well. Look, there's better talent around. There's better talent on some teams in our division. But we always knew we had what it took to win. We just had to prove it to ourselves, and early on we did. Our confidence was so high, so real, I knew we could rise above the everyday ups and downs of the season.
For the Dodgers of 1986 and 87, May had been the cruelest of months. And for a time in 88, it looked like deja vu. After moving out to a three-game lead over the Astros on May 11, the Dodgers found themselves in a slump, which culminated with three losses in a row to the Mets at Dodger Stadium. The Mets would ultimately have the Dodgers reeling all season long. But as things turned out, the most damaging loss New York would inflict didn't show up in the standings.
The 1-2 pitch is high and inside and hits something, and it hit Alfredo Griffin's hand.
Hit it and broke it, causing the Dodgers shortstop to miss a total of 57 games. In the recent past, injuries like that had crippled the Dodgers. But this time, there would be a smooth transition at shortstop. In fact, with Dave Anderson in the lineup as a starter, the Dodgers moved into first place on May 26th, a position they would eventually hold for the rest of the year.
I really didn't know what to expect when the season started. I knew I wouldn't get a chance to play that much, but I think you have to be prepared for that. It happened at a good time for me. I didn't really have that much of a spring training. The first 6 weeks of the season when Alfredo did play, it gave me a chance to work on a lot of different things. That was really my spring training. And so when the call did come and Alfredo went down with a broken hand, I was ready to play.
Being ready to play was a phrase readily understood around the Dodger clubhouse in 1988. Sure, the Dodgers had their regulars, but they also had a group of veterans who more than just filled in when they were needed. This was a total team effort, with many different players playing many different roles. For instance, there was Franklin Stubbs, who started 57 games at first, half of them over the final month and a half of the season. Danny Heap also contributed, batting .305 in 35 starts. While Tracy Woodson started 45 games at first and third after being called up from Albuquerque in early July. Catcher Rick Dempsey got the starting call in 45 games and showed that durability and experience can be a valuable asset to any team with championship aspirations.
They're very much needed to form a winning ball club. They fill a role that younger players simply can't fill. They have to have the experience, they have to have been through some of the frustrations, and at the same time, they have to have tremendous inner confidence in their abilities, because they're going to be put in roles that are critical roles and yet not given the chance to play every day. And the spirit that those players have on the bench who do not have the opportunity to play every day is a major factor in a team's success.
The unofficial leader of the Dodger reserves was Mickey Hatcher, whose boundless spirit fast became contagious. So, in fact, did the nickname Hatcher came up with for his contemporaries, the stuntmen.
You know, you get in situations where, you know, a lot of times in spring training where the guys would play their six innings, it was like, you know, if something was going to happen, it would be timeout. Okay, throw the stuntman in there, and just like in the movies, if a fight was to break out or something, they wouldn't let the main actors get hurt. They'd throw the stuntman in there, and they'd get beat up, and then they'd flash back, and there'd be the hero with no scars on his face.
They just loved to play, and they have a lot of fun, and they began to believe that this team could not be successful without them, and they knew that any time they would play, they knew that they had to uphold that tradition of the stuntman.
Look at the future looks bright, 'cause living right, out of the darkness, into the light, I'm living right.
In June, the Dodgers were indeed living right, especially Mike Marshall, who hit .327, drove in 17 runs during a month in which the Dodgers increased their lead over the Astros to 5 games. Another Dodger who kept up his hot hitting in June was John Shelby, who had come off the disabled list on May 12th and 2 days later began a streak in which he hit in 24 straight games, the longest in the majors in 88.
I didn't anticipate on having a hitting streak. I just went out, I relaxed, and I took it a day at a time. But, you know, at that time, we were in the thick of things, and we were trying to hold on to first. And I just made winning the first priority, to go out and contribute, you know, offensively or defensively, and just help the club win. That's all I want to do, is help us win.
I've come to historically probably one of the finest organizations that has ever been in operation. I come out here to win. That's my number one goal every day, and believe in personal sacrifice if that's what it takes to win ball games. And, you know, people get superstitious about this game, and, you know, I've said it many times, I'd take an 0 for 5 and a W over a 3 for 5 and a loss any day, because, again, when I leave spring training, I'm leaving to be a world champion.
There's no question that in 1988, the Dodgers were a team in the true sense of the word. But on every team, there still must be a leader. And on the Dodgers, that leader was without question Kirk Gibson, the National League's most valuable player in 1988. There really isn't an accurate way to measure Gibson's worth to the Dodgers. Oh, sure, he led the team in a bunch of offensive categories, but over the years, a lot of guys have done that. More importantly, Kirk Gibson was the heart of the Dodgers. He was the fire, the emotion, the determination, the drive. He was a winner, something he proved day in and day out.
I've made some statements early when I signed about what kind of player I was, and I think and feel very certain that I've done that. And I'm just an aggressive type player that comes out and gives you everything I've got. Every day, I'll give you 100% of 100% if I'm 100%. I'll give you 100% of 75% if I got 75%.
He knows what he can get out of his body and out of his ability, and he goes out there and he does it. He's not afraid to take chances. He's a smart ball player, but he gets the most out of his talent. And I think that that's something we needed to show here on our ball club, is that you, even if you have the talent, you've got to go out there and push yourself and work hard and get the most out of it. And I think it's rubbed off on a lot of ball players.
I know it psychs me up when he's out there going crazy, and I think that's what people relate to as far as it being contagious. It kind of, you know, gets you going and gets your blood going and psychs you up. And I think that's the only way to play baseball, with all the intensity and emotion and enthusiasm that you have, and to channel it in the right direction, and then just let it go. And that's the way to play.
Gibson's been known to let it go with the best of them, but even that has its worth.
I am a madman at times.
Early in the year, the Dodgers realized there was a lesson to be learned from Gibson's madness.
We believe in ourselves, and we have a little saying about what kind of team we are after the game. We're a very good team, but we say in locker room language, and you just have to keep affirming to yourselves and both collectively as a team on what exactly you are and what you do stand for, and that's kind of the way I am in the locker room. I will yell out what I call affirmations, affirming true positive beliefs in yourselves and as a team.
As the Dodgers held on to first place throughout July, their list of improbable finishes began to take shape. The first came against the Cardinals on July 6th, when Franklin Stubbs capped off a 7-run surge in the eighth. One place the Dodgers were clearly living right was on the road, where in 88 they had the best record in the National League. Right after the All-Star break, the Dodgers went into Chicago and remarkably swept 5 games from the Cubs, en route to winning 11 of 16 on that trip alone. By now, the Dodgers were the surprise of the league, but one thing the league wasn't surprised about was the intense play of Steve Sachs.
I get on base and like Tommy Lasorda says, I'm the guy that brings the ball down court and these guys score. So it's a great feeling to know that one guy is pulling for the next, and if this guy doesn't do it, the next guy will pick you up. It's a great feeling. That's what baseball is all about. That's what winning's all about, is all working together.
Pitching is an art. There's no other organization that I know about that teaches pitching better than the Dodgers. From day one, I think we're born and bred Dodger pitchers. They drum it into our heads how to pitch in certain situations, how to pitch to certain players, how to even dissect our own mechanics, our mechanical needs out there on the mound. We learn all that stuff. It doesn't just happen. But you still have to be able to win those close games, those 2-1 games. And not just me, the whole staff, the starters all the way down to the relievers. That's what it's all about. That's why our pitching is so good.
Once again in 1988, Fernando Valenzuela was expected to be the anchor of the Dodger pitching staff. But Fernando was plagued with injuries throughout the year and finally went on the disabled list July 31st. The same thing happened to future Hall of Famer Don Sutton, who won some big games early on before injuring himself as well. That left the bulk of the work to Oral Hershiser and two young pitchers who are relative newcomers to the Dodger organization, Tim Leary and Tim Belcher.
This guy tells Fred Flair, Tim Belcher is nothing but a 5-inning pitcher.
I didn't say you were nothing
this
but a 5-inning
This is supposed to be my
pitcher.
Friend.
I didn't use the word
my carpool
nothing.
Pal.
Well, I was thinking
well, tell the story right.
At least he's a team
you
player.
You told him that, though.
I said you are a 5-inning pitcher.
I respect
say you were nothing
objectivity.
But a 5-inning pitcher.
Well, that's true, though.
Right then I was.
By season's end, Belcher proved he was more than just a 5-inning pitcher, winning 9 of his last 11 decisions to finish the season with an impressive 12-6 record and a 2.91 ERA. Tim Leary's ERA was the same 2.91, To go along with that, Leary also won a career-high 17 times and finished second in the National League with 6 shutouts. Still, all the Dodgers starters might not have enjoyed so much success if it weren't for the bullpen.
Just to get all what the record was for the season.
19-11.
All right. 19-11. Don't believe those guys. The judge, they helped those guys. That's why they won.
This is the beef of the L.A. Dodgers pitching staff.
Fortunately for the Dodgers in 1988, the bullpen hardly fell down on the job at all.
With Jay Howell, Jesse Orozco, Alejandro Pena, Brian Holt, and Tim Cruz, we knew we had arms down there, but we didn't know how they were all going to fit together, how they were going to be used.
Hey, Ron. Hey, it looks we're going to put Horton in the sixth inning, huh? Then Martinez in the seventh, Pena the eighth, and Orozco is going to finish it up, huh? All right, buddy. Okay. Bye.
You got the sixth, Rick.
And they've come together about as well as anyone could have imagined, and they've really been the backbone of our ball club.
Just 1 year ago, the Dodger bullpen had been the team's weak link. But in 1988, the bullpen had 27 wins, saved a National League high and team record 49 games. Amazingly, where the Dodgers of the recent past had trouble finding one stopper, Tommy Lasorda had the luxury of three. There was Jesse Orozco, the lefty out of the pen who won 3 games while saving 9. Then there was Alejandro Pena, who led the Dodgers with 60 appearances on his way towards saving 12 games with a 1.91 ERA. But the Dodgers' stopper among stoppers in 88 was Jay Howell, who finished the season with 13 saves after the All-Star break and a season total of 21.
When I come down, I always put a towel on. I make sure the tag's on the right side. And I button up my jacket for 3 buttons. No more, no less. It's always 3. I come down and I sit in my same seat every day and I go up to Mark Cressy and he crosses his legs. I knock his foot off his knee, say truce, and can I please look at the lineup? I look at the lineup and I sit back and get ready for the game till the fourth inning.
Superstitious Brian Holton tied up opponents all year long as the Dodgers' middleman. Holton won 7 times while finishing with a 1.70 ERA and shared his role effectively with Tim Cruz, who won 4 times without losing in 88. By late July, the Dodgers seemed ready for the rest of the summer. But in a 2-week span, they lost 9 of 12 games and saw their lead over the Astros fall from 7 games to just a half. Trouble loomed on the horizon, but all year long, the Dodgers hadn't lost more than 3 in a row, and they weren't about to start now. One reason was an early August trade in which John Tudor was acquired for the Dodgers' offensive leader over the past 9 years, Pedro Guerrero. Tudor replaced Fernando Valenzuela in the starting rotation and pitched well. So did Ramon Martinez, whom the Dodgers had called up from the minors, and the team responded by steadily increasing its lead. At one point, the Dodgers won 15 of 20 as they turned back challenge after challenge with dramatic flair.
And wouldn't you know, the Dodgers and the Giants, they go right to the wall. The Dodgers have run out of hitters. They have to send Tim Leary to the plate, and the count goes to 3-2. Here's the pitch, 3-2.
Line drive, base hit. Leary wins it. Dodgers win 2-1.
Have the winning run at second base with 2 outs in a 3-3 tie. We're in the bottom of the 9th inning. And the ball gets by Santovania. Here comes Gibson. He's going to keep on coming. And throw to the plate. He scores. Dodgers win.
9 strikeouts for Mike Scott. The 1-0 pitch, the drive to right and deep. Back goes Bass. Away back. It's gone. A 3-3 tie in the 9th inning. And the Dodgers now trying to steal a game that it looked like they were going to lose. 2 out, Shelby at third on a full count to Hamilton. Franco is ready, and John delivers.
swung on, a high drive into deep left. Back goes Daniels, it's gone!
Look at the future, the future looks bright, cause they're the right, they're the right.
With their late summer surge, the Dodgers had solidified their lead in the West, and much of the credit had to go to the eventual National League Manager of the Year, Tommy Lasorda. In his 12th and most fulfilling season as the Dodgers skipper, Lasorda did a masterful job, and even reached a personal milestone on August 27th when he won his 1,000th game.
If you hit 300 in the big leagues, you did it yourself. If you win 20 games, you pitched the ball. But when you're a manager and you receive any kind of recognition whatsoever, it can only become a reality because of the contributions of your players.
I really and truly need my players. And if I'm gonna hug them, I'm gonna tell them how much I appreciate what they do for me. I'm gonna eat with them. I'm gonna live with them because I need them.
I wanna thank all the players who have made it possible for me to be the manager to win 1,000 games wearing a Dodger uniform.
See, we can be here tonight. And if I'm sick, the game will go on, won't it? Mm-hmm. Now, tomorrow night, all the players are sick and I'm okay. What happens?
Sounds like no game.
No game. Okay? So that's the point that I'm trying to bring out to you and people.
For a baseball player, September can either be the best month or the worst. It depends on where you are in the standings. I've had some pretty rough Septembers in my career, but this one was different. Not only did I have a division clinch to look forward to, I also had a chance to be part of baseball history. What Oral did at the end of the year was really unbelievable. I know it's something I'll never forget.
What Oral Hershiser did in September of 1988 is something history won't soon forget. But Oral wasn't satisfied with his first 20-win season. He kept on winning, and he kept on throwing shutout after shutout.
Oral Hershiser wins his 21st, no runs, six hits, and one error for the Braves.
Oral Hershiser is one out away from having a 40-inning consecutive scoreless streak. Here's the pitch. Popped up. This should be it. Socha throws away the mask in foul ground off to the right of the plate. He's got it, and Oral Hershiser has his fourth straight shutout, his seventh successive complete game, runs his consecutive scoreless inning string to 40, and lowers the magic number needed for the Dodgers to clinch the National League West to 4.
With the streak now at 40 consecutive innings, people were becoming well aware of what lay ahead. The Major League record of 58 straight scoreless innings held by former Dodger great Don Drysdale. On the night of September 23rd, Hershiser got 9 innings closer to Drysdale when he shut out the Giants in San Francisco. The streak was now at 49, but before Oral would even get a chance at Drysdale's record, the Dodgers had a little matter of a Western Division title to take care of. That came in San Diego on September 26th.
Pitch to Marvell Wynn, swung on, a fly ball to right field. Sack backing out and calling, he's got it.
Nothing feels better than reaching for the top. Once you get started, you ain't never gonna wanna stop.
With the Western Division title now firmly in their grasp, all eyes turned to Oral and his attempt to catch Drysdale.
I happened to be in Friday. He's having lunch and he walked in by himself, so I sat and ate lunch with him. And I was bound and determined not to bring it up. And while I was eating my soup, I asked the waiter if she could scarf up a USA Today sports section that somebody might have left on a table somewhere. So she brings it back, and I'm eating my soup, so I just hand it to Oral. And right there on the front page,
the car story.
About the street. And I'm like, oh, man, I didn't want to bring that up.
Car story. Big picture of Drysdale, big picture of me, the whole spread.
No,
I said, oh, look here, Tim.
On the night of September 28th, Oral Hershiser set out to make baseball history, and the magnitude of the moment even got to him.
To go out and to take batting practice was fine and get my normal rub down, but as soon as I picked up the ball in the bullpen, I really felt my stomach start to jump and started to warm up, and I got to a point in the warm-ups where I just turned to Perry and said, I don't know, but I am just really nervous.
I could see when he was warming up, he was doing a little prancing around more than he usually has, and you know, obvious, for obvious reasons.
And he goes, you'll be all right as soon as you get the first guy out. And then about two pitches later, I turned to him and he looked at me and he goes, did you just hear that? I said, no. He goes, my stomach just growling. I'm nervous too.
Nervous or not, Oral knew exactly what he had to do, and he didn't want to let himself down.
Did not want to choke. I wanted to get to that point in the game where the excitement and the intensity built, so at least I felt that feeling of going after a no-hitter or going after a perfect game where the stands and everybody knew what was going on.
What was going on was that Oral was throwing yet another shutout.
After the fifth inning, I felt excitement instead of nerves from then point on, because I had reached that point of even if I fall short, I've gotten myself an opportunity and gotten to go through this feeling.
That feeling lasted into the ninth when Hershiser tied Drysdale's record. As fate would have it, the Dodgers would be held scoreless too. So the game moved into extra innings, giving Hershiser a chance to top Drysdale's scoreless inning streak.
Right before the 10th inning, I looked up into the broadcast booth for about 2 or 3 minutes, and I was looking for him. And then I looked over the dugout and looked for him, and I couldn't find him. And so I went and I tipped my hat to the clubhouse, up to the press box. And so I saluted him and said, I'm going to go now.
Eugene O'Neill wrote a great line. He said, there's no present and there's no future. There's only the past, over and over, now. And that's what we're looking at. The past, 20 years ago, we're looking at it again. Remarkable. 1-2 to Moreland. Hershiser ready, and the 1-2 pitch is swung on, a fly ball to right. Gonzalez backs up, he's got it, and Hershiser has the record. The Dodgers now are going to go all out to greet him.
Oral Hershiser had rewritten the record book, and in the process, broke a record they said would never be broken.
You know, every year we come to spring training with one goal in mind. To win a championship. A lot of the so-called experts, they didn't think we had much of a chance this year. But I had a good feeling about this team. I'm so proud of the way the guys played this year. Every one of them. You know, it's tough to compare seasons or teams. I can find some good in all of them. Every one of my winning seasons have been precious. But in a few years, when I look back on this season, I'm sure it'll mean something special to me.
Let's talk about the Mets.
Guys, let's go over the scouting report on the Mets here before we get going.
What did we lose, 10 out of 11?
Mookie Wilson's been swinging the bat pretty good, Brian. How are you going to pitch him?
It wasn't that we were trying to play too hard against them. It's you just, they caught you on the downward momentum side of every series.
Throw him some breaking balls. If I throw a fastball inside, I'm going to come in way off the plate.
The best thing we can do is to score early and to take their crowd out of the ballgame, if we can, when we're in New York. You take that crowd out, and it takes half the pressure off you.
Let's go over to McReynolds, because he's been killing everybody, you know?
You got the first game. What do you think?
I just view them like I do on the other team.
That's right. That's all you have to do. You just
try to keep the breaking ball down on the plate, try to get him to chase it. I think Jay, with your fastball, you can throw him up and in.
I mean, if I'm playing Atlanta or if I'm playing the Mets, I go at it the same way. Because I just
throw your shutouts all the same way?
No, I just go about it the same way.
Yeah.
I throw my shutouts all the same way. That's right.
The last guy I want to go over is Jeffries. He's come up here and lit the world on fire.
We've earned the right to be there. They've earned the right to be there. We're both going to start 0-0. Let's just go play. Let's go shoot the guns at each other and see who wins.
It was supposed to be the great playoff mismatch, the powerful Mets against the Pop Gun Dodgers. The Dodgers, however, knew they had the hottest pitcher in baseball on their side, And in Game 1, Oral Hershiser went to the mound to face New York, not having given up a run in his previous 59 innings. Once again, Oral was brilliant, holding a 2-0 lead into the ninth. But the Mets came back, scoring the first run of Oral in 68 innings and chasing him from the game just two outs away from a win. Oral gave way to Jay Howell, who got the second out of the inning, and then two strikes on Gary Carter.
Shelby coming on, dives, cannot come up with it. Strawberry scores. Here comes McReynolds to the plate. He will score in a collision with Socha, and the Mets lead 3-2.
It was a very, very tough loss for us. But the next day, as I told our players, hey, if it was a one-game series, we're out. But it's the best of seven, which means you have to win four. They've only won one. So we bounce back tonight, and we're even with them.
Reaction to an insulting article written by Mets starter David Cohn was one thing that helped the Dodgers get even. Another was Mickey Hatcher.
Well, I thought after that loss, I needed a little spark plug in there. Someone who could create something. Hatcher has a knack of doing that. He has a knack of getting guys fired up. And I thought, now is the time we need that. We need that little spark.
Line drive, base hit, inside third and down the line. In comes Belcher. Here comes Sachs. Johnson throw to the plate. He scores. 4-0 Dodgers.
By the time the second inning was over, the Dodgers had jumped all over Cohn for a 5-0 lead, and then sat back and marveled at the way rookie pitcher Tim Belcher handled the pressure of the playoffs. Belcher struck out 10 Mets as the Dodgers went on to win Game 2, 6-3. So it was goodbye Dodger Stadium and hello Shea. After a rainout, Game 3 was played in miserable conditions on Saturday afternoon. The steady rain and bone-chilling cold didn't exactly make for quality baseball, but it was exciting. Things got so bad that even Oral Hershiser needed help.
Slices one to left. Gibson coming to the line, dives, and makes a catch as he was falling down in left field. Kirk Gibson, losing his balance, slipping, still able to recapture his balance and one hand a ball that was slicing away from him. Quite a play by Kirk Gibson.
The day, however, also had its dark side. Reliever Jay Howell was removed from the game, later suspended for two more for having pine tar on his glove. But worst of all for the Dodgers was that the Mets scored five times in the eighth to win Game 3, 8-4. Down two games to one, it was time for the Dodgers to do some soul searching. The Dodgers grabbed an early lead, but John Tudor gave up a game-tying homer to Darryl Strawberry in the fourth. Soon after that, the Dodgers fell behind 4-2, and as the game moved into the ninth, the situation certainly looked bleak. The Dodgers were just three outs away from going down 3-1 in the series. If the Dodgers had gone down quietly that night, they still could have held their heads up high. After all, no one even expected them to be in this situation in the first place. But that's not what this team was about in 1988. All year long, the Dodgers had won when they had to. All year long, they had the courage and conviction to to summon up improbable finish after improbable finish. The time had come for another. First, John Shelby worked out a walk. And then Mike Socia came to bat, having hit just three homers all year.
And good and ready. Dwight's fastball is hammered to right. Back goes Strawberry. Away back. It is gone. And the Dodger dugout is wild in disbelief and joy.
Miraculously, the Dodgers had tied the score. And three innings later, Kirk Gibson untied it with another memorable homer.
Here's the 0-1 pitch. High fly ball to deep right center field. Way back with Ronnie Dykstra. Home run, Kirk Gibson.
Gibson's homer gave the Dodgers a 5-4 lead, but the Mets weren't through yet. In the bottom of the inning, they loaded the bases with two out and had Kevin McReynolds set to hit. Incredibly, the Dodgers counted with Orel Hershiser in relief. Just a day earlier in Game 3, Orel had pitched seven innings, but on this night, the Dodgers were desperate.
And the 1-1 pitch to McReynolds. Fly ball to center field. Shelby coming up, still coming, still coming. He got it! Dodgers win! The Dodgers have tied the National League Championship Series.
Back at Shea, barely 11 hours later for Game 5, Rick Dempsey put the Dodgers on top first once again.
And now it comes to his hitter, and Dempsey whacks it down the left field line. Fair ball in the corner. Here comes Marshall. Right back of him is Shelby, and the Dodgers lead 2-0 on a double by Rick Dempsey.
The Dodgers scored once more in the inning to take a 3-0 lead. And then in the fifth, Kirk Gibson put the game away.
And the 2-1 pitch to Kirk Gibson. Swung on and hammered to right. If it's fair, it's gone. It is gone. And the Dodgers lead 6-0.
Once again, the job of protecting the big lead went to Tim Belcher. And as he did in Game 2, Belcher had the Mets in a state of disbelief for most of the afternoon. Eventually, Belcher gave way to Brian Holton, who had come on in the eighth to protect the Dodger lead.
Ball lifted into shallow right center. A trio of Dodgers, a diving catch by Shelby. And the Dodgers win it.
So the Dodgers had taken two games from the Mets in New York and had come home hoping to wrap up the series in six. But the Mets would have none of that as David Cone pitched a masterful five-hitter in New York's 5-1 win. It had all come down to a single game, and the Dodger faithful were ready. Who better to beat the Mets than the incomparable Orel Hershiser? Believe it or not, Hershiser was still looking for his first win of the playoffs. And in the bottom of the second against Ron Darling, the Dodgers made sure he would get it.
The first pitch, he bunts in the air, but it's going to drop and he's going to beat it out. Hershiser ready, swings, it's a ground ball slowly to third.
By the time they were through, the Dodgers had scored five runs in the second to take a 6-0 lead. With Orel on the mound, that must have seemed pretty safe. And as things turned out, it was.
It has been Hershiser's night. And he looks in now to make what he hopes will be his last pitch. Fastball, got him looking.
I'm thinking, we're in the Fall Classic. This is where we wanted to be. And I thank God for giving us the strength, the togetherness, the spirit, and the will to achieve that made this team a most precious one. It made it a team of destiny, a dream team.
We're proud of the players who performed for the Dodgers during the 1988 season. The team played with the desire and dedication.
So high, so real. I knew we could rise above the everyday ups and downs.
From day one, I think we're born and bred Dodger pitchers. They drum it into our heads how to pitch.
A lot of the so-called experts, they didn't think we had much of a chance this year. But I had a good feeling about this team.
Because again, when I leave spring training, I'm leaving to be a world champion.
So the Dodgers were in the World Series. And just like the playoffs, they were decided underdogs once again. This time the favorites were the Oakland A's, a team that had won 104 games during the season. Even worse, Kirk Gibson was sidelined with an injury. With all that, the Dodgers were still prepared to just say no to the experts. They knew that the series had to be won on the field, and in the bottom of the first, they went about doing so. Hatcher's high-speed tour of the bases left the Dodgers sky high. But in the top of the second, they were brought down to earth. Pitcher Tim Belcher suffered an untimely case of World Series jitters. First, he loaded the bases, and then with two out, he had to face Jose Canseco, the major league leader in home runs. But on this night, that was all the scoring Oakland would do. The Dodgers bared down on defense and kept themselves in the game. All year long, this was a Dodger team that picked itself up when it was down, and this night would be no exception. The Dodgers scored to narrow the lead to one. But in the ninth, the A's brought in Dennis Eckersley, the Major League's best reliever in 1988. Eckersley took care of the first two batters in the ninth, and with Kirk Gibson seemingly out for the night, the Dodgers entrusted what looked to be their final at-bat to Mike Davis.
They're down to their last out, bottom of the ninth. A's 4, Dodgers 3.
If he gets on, we're going to hear some roar.
And he walked it. And look who's coming up.
I asked my manager and what he thought. I gave him the circumstances and the abilities that I was somewhat restricted under. He said, I want you in there, big boy. And I said, I'll give you everything I have.
Fouled away. With the left knee bothering him, he can't push off. Well, now he can't push off and he can't land.
He's going to use all arms. Look at his crowd on its feet. What a tribute.
I enjoy entertaining those people. I enjoy hearing those people buzz. I enjoy hearing that crowd.
0-1. Fouled away again.
And that's why I'm on the field. I'm there to do that type of deal. Of course, these are the types of things that solidify and help you find your identity and help you build that character.
14 fastballs in a row, that's all he's been throwing. There
Erickson shaking his left leg, making it quiver like a horse trying to get rid of a troublesome fly. There he goes, way outside. He's stolen it.
If you're going to listen to things that are said by media people and or other so-called experts about what your destiny is, then you know, you're defeating your whole purpose by even stepping on the field.
Sacks waiting on deck, but the game right now is at the plate. High fly ball in the right field. She is gone.
After another of their improbable endings, the Dodgers got themselves ready for Game 2, inspired by the fact that Oral Hershiser would be on the mound. And like he had done in the playoffs, Oral was on target once again.
Four consecutive strikeouts and five in the game.
But this time, Oral didn't reserve his heroics for the mound as he started the Dodgers' key third-inning rally. Mike Marshall's three-run homer capped a five-run inning. And with Oral on the mound, the A's just didn't have a chance.
Got him.
This time, it was a three-hit shutout as the Dodgers took Game 2, 6-0. The Dodgers went into Oakland knowing they needed just two more wins to become world champions. But they also knew the A's hadn't yet begun to flex their muscles. That all changed when Mark McGwire won Game 3 with a ninth-inning homer. Before Game 4, the Dodger dugout was understandably tense. But the mood changed quickly when the Dodgers scored two runs in the top of the first and added another in the third to take a 3-1 lead. By the seventh, the lead was down to one, and with two out, the A's would load the bases. Jay Howell was called on to face Mark McGwire, and unlike the night before, Howell won the battle, getting McGwire to pop out to end the inning. In the ninth, the Dodgers' 4-3 lead was in jeopardy again, especially with Jose Canseco facing Howell with a runner on first. One batter later, the game was over. The next night, the Dodgers were off and running, and once again, it was Mickey Hatcher who got them going in the first.
And there's a high drive into deep left field. Back goes Javier. Gone. Mickey Hatcher, a two-run home run.
For the 10th time in their 12th postseason game, the Dodgers had scored first. Even more amazing, after hitting just one homer all year long, Mickey Hatcher had now hit two in the World Series. And although he really never could get the hang of the forearm bash, by now it was clear the Dodgers had the A's number.
They let him swing and a drive to right. Canseco going back. It is gone.
Mike Davis' two-run homer in the fifth gave the Dodgers a 4-1 lead. A world championship that had seemed so improbable back in spring training now seemed inevitable. The reason, Oral Hershiser, who was brilliant once again, holding the A's to just 2 runs and 4 hits. For Hershiser, it was a fitting conclusion to a brilliant season. 24 wins, a record-setting 59-inning scoreless streak, a Cy Young Award, a playoff and World Series MVP. And now, he and his teammates were just one pitch away from becoming world champions.
Got him. They've done it. Like the 1969 Mets, it's the impossible dream revisited.
Fred and I accept this, Commissioner, on behalf of the great team we have in the front office and on the field. We're very happy and we're very thankful. Thank you.
What more can be said about the 1988 Los Angeles Dodgers? Here was a team that believed in itself and was beloved by its fans. A team that knew it had a chance right from the start.
I'm happy to be in L.A., and all I got to say is let's go get them Dodgers, and let's bring a world championship back here.